world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Rollins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
And good day, good night. Welcome to Soccer Today for Thursday, August 19th, 2021. I'm Kev Larame, joined by Duane Rollins, as always. And Duane, it is a big Thursday because we had a busy Wednesday and also a busy Tuesday when you think about it in the world of soccer in North America. But first, how are you today?
I'm doing well. It felt like the start of the full season again. And I know that we don't have seasons because we cover the game in Europe and North America, so there's no break for us. But when there's crossing over, that's to me when the prime season's happening. So I spent most of yesterday afternoon watching the Champions League qualifiers and then immediately segued into watching MLS and then even throw a Campiel game on this morning. So it's kind of feeling like I'm in the grind again. So let's do this thing.
A lot of soccer. And of course, we're talking about Major League Soccer Wednesday night. A couple of games on Tuesday, too, that we can touch on. Talk about the Concacaf League later on in the show. We're playing CD FAS, and we have the results of that game. And, of course, where they're going to go next, we also know that. And it's a familiar name if you have been paying attention to the Continental game over the last few years. Also, we're going to talk about the Canadian Championship, a team qualified for the quarterfinals on Tuesday, and we'll talk about Halifax Blainville that took place at Wanderers Ground on Tuesday evening. But first, Wayne, let's start with Major League Soccer, and let's start with the first game that was on the schedule last night in Major League Soccer. We're talking about TFC, of course, and of course for TFC, here we go, Atlanta. Ezequiel Barco scored the game winner at the 20th minute. A heavy rotated lineup. We'll get to the lineup in a second, but what is your overall thought on this game?
Okay. I mean, first off, they lost again, and that's got to be where you start and finish any conversation about this game. I will say that if you want to have moral victories conversations about playing well, then that's not the TFC that I've grown used to watching for the last 5 years. Sure, they had a lot of the ball in the second half. Sure, once they put some of their more regular players back into the lineup, they did produce some chances, and they absolutely could have scored a goal in there to get a draw or perhaps a win, but a draw would have been more likely. That would not have been unfair based on the overall play had that happened. But the bottom line is, this is a team now that went in there and just sort of mailed it in, is a strong way to put it, but like there didn't seem to be a lot of urgency. Like any rhetoric that the club gives about, oh, we need to win, you know, just win three or four in a row and we're right back. No, they don't believe that internally. You can tell. Javier Perez, I think, did a good job off the hop to sort of turn things around quickly so that they weren't quite, you know, losing 7-1 anymore. But we've kind of hit a wall again. And I don't know what the purpose of the rest of the season is. Like, we'll talk about the rotated lineup in a second here. And in some ways, maybe that's for the best, to just show that whole lineup and have everyone lined up and decide, make some decisions about next year, because there are some tough decisions that are going to have to be made. And look, all teams go through this. All good teams, you know, have a time when it ends. And the question is, you know, if you've ever been to a great keg party back when you were younger, you know, you're having a great time till 2 a.m, but 2 a.m. rolls around and there's a fine line between 2 and 3, and choosing when to leave that party is absolutely vital to your memory of that party. Do you want to remember, you know, the three sad guys sitting there staring at each other around the keg at 3 a.m. with the host trying to kick them out? Or do you want to leave when everyone was still popping? You know, you got to time it right.
If you leave just at the right time, your lasting memory will be when it's all jumping and popping and everybody's having fun. No one's puking yet. The cops haven't showed up yet. Yeah, it's a perfect time to leave the party.
Yeah, exactly. And that's, you know, we're clearly already a little, we're at about 2:30 a.m. right now. So, you know, it's time to start sweeping out.
And the party's over. There's not going to be an after party. No playoffs for TFC in 2021.
Well, no. I mean, all that they have left for to really play for in the rest of the season is the Voyageurs Cup. We'll talk about that a bit in the second half of the show. You know, both to win this year. And I suppose I'm increasingly becoming convinced that the 2020 Voyageurs Cup game is not going to happen between Forge and TFC, which is a shame. But, yeah, you know, with Forge going deeper into the the Concacaf Nations League and TFC's has to, you know, obligations at MLS, like, when do you play it? And there comes a point where, you know, if you're playing that game in December, like, what's the point, right? Like, a year and a half.
Yes, of course. Of course. And we'll talk about the Concacaf League a bit later today, of course, with Forge progressing into now the quarterfinals of that competition. We mentioned the rotated lineup of TFC. Let's take a look, Duane. We had, of course, Patrick Mullins on top, Achara on the bench, Josie Altidore injured for now. We had, of course, Schaffelberg, Osorio, Laria, or Lahi. Both are okay, according to Richie. Michael Bradley and Okello in the defensive midfield. Mauro, Zavaleta, Gonzalez, Oro in your back line. And Westberg in net. Does that say anything to what's happening maybe in the weekend? Because it was a busy weekend. Of course, a busy midweek in Major League Soccer, which will lead to a busy weekend also. Most teams are playing in both slots. So what does that rotated lineup mean, if anything? And is it truly maybe a time to just look ahead, get what we can out of the season, which is experience, and maybe learning and not getting blown off and playing for the famous honor?
I think what it says is that Perez has looked at the schedule and decided that the Miami game was more winnable than the Atlanta game, which, you know, he's right. But that also has an underlying message that he doesn't think they can win both. And he threw him out there and saw what those guys could do. And as I said, it wasn't actually a bad game. If this was in an isolation of a season that otherwise was going fine, I don't think anyone would have an issue with last night's game. They played pretty well at times. They created some stuff, particularly considering it was a younger lineup. Schaffelberg, I thought, had a really good game. Schaffelberg has impressed a lot this year when he's had a chance. And I think maybe if you're looking for silver linings in what's been a pretty bad season, his emergence as possibly a player that can add something out there is something you want to talk about. The conversation after the game, though, as it has been with all TFC games of late, has been mostly negative and mostly about who's not performing rather than who did perform, because there's been more of them. You know, Soltado, again, comes down as a conversation. There's a legitimate debate over the last 3 weeks. It's gone from everyone saying, like, oh, he's pretty exciting, let's keep an eye on him and see what happens in that 3 weeks. It's gone to, like, there's a strict divide, 50-50 almost in the fan base between whether he's a useful signing or not. You know, increasingly we're hearing some rumblings that maybe he's not all that great in the dressing room either, but you know, I've heard that from a few people. You put that on a shelf and decide what you want to do with it.
Yeah.
Just choices have to be made. And obviously the most obvious choice is Perez, the coaching change. And beyond that, whether or not you want to move into what is clearly going to be a, you know, rebuilding, refreshing, whatever you want to call it, phase in TFC, and whether you want this current management to be the people making those choices. And, you know, that's two levels. Mm-hmm. I have been pretty clear that because Bill Manning's role is different than just picking players. So, and I think Bill Manning from, you know, I have conversations with people in Ontario soccer all the time that really like what Bill Manning has done to mend some bridges, or to mend some bridges, is that the term anyway, to build bridges. There you go. To build some bridges
or mend fences, you choose.
Yeah, exactly. Mixing my metaphors, get your bingo card out. He's done some good work in the interior soccer community to sort of bring people back together to patch up some divides that were there before. And he's done good work in the business side. There's a lot of sponsorships. Toronto does pretty well. They make some good money through that stuff. I mean, that doesn't excite fans, but it excites MLSC. So, you know, he's a different kind of question. But what I do, if I'm going to be blamey on Manning, I think maybe he does, because he has enough of a history in the game that he kind of likes to dip his toe in the technical side of things a little bit too much, I think. And I think that's some of the problems, because if you look back to what really made TFC successful in 2015, 16, 17 in that build, it was that everyone had a clear and defined role. It was, you know, Bezbachenko got the players, Vanny coached the players, Manning managed the whole system. And those three roles worked well together. And once Bez came out, it sort of threw everything into a frenzy. I'm not sure Curtis has ever fully felt in control. There's always seems to have been a battle between Curtis and Manning, or Curtis and Vanny, which I think ultimately left to Vanny leaving, because there was a contract on the table for him to sign, and things were going well. And then suddenly he just decided he didn't want to do it anymore and took his coaching staff with him. Jason Bent left with him. I think that was telling too. The year before, Robin Fraser leaving. All those things in hindsight kind of add up to maybe that front office needs a focus point. And whether Manning stays or not, I think could be up to him, but I think he has to decide whether he wants to put someone in place that can have a clear vision, can be given a clear vision and given a clear mandate and given being empowered to do that. And I think that's where TFC is. And all of this conversation has very little to do with last night's 1-0 loss to Atlanta United. I appreciate, but that's where we are at with TFC right now.
I'm going to take you in another direction, and forgive me if I'm surprising you with this. I do want to talk about Atlanta, because Atlanta is making the train back to go at least straight and in the proper rail settings. You know, they're on the right track, if you want to use that expression. And Arroyo made his debut for the club last night, and the former French striker who won the league with Lille last year and Kenny and Jonathan David. But Arroyo seems to be an interesting piece for Atlanta and might be fitting perfectly for them tactically. Pineda, the new manager for Atlanta, who was taking charge of his first game, of course, last night in a win, 1-0 against Toronto, was talking about the day before in the day minus one of the pregame press conference about how Arroyo seems to be perfectly suited for his tactical, I guess, philosophy, and how he wants to set it up in his starting lineup. And we saw already he came on last night, and we'll see how it goes forward. But the 5-3-2 Atlanta's building with the pressure of the wingbacks, because that's the new reality. Wingbacks, and then when you play against a wingback, you have to tactically adjust to it. And if we're just looking at Montreal game, and we'll get to Montreal in a second, but it applies to Atlanta and TFC here, because TFC did not technically or tactically adjust to Atlanta's five-man backline or the wingback. Montreal's opponent, Duane, so Cincinnati, New York, for example, over the last couple of games. Before playing Montreal, they were playing in a different formation. They were playing a 4-4-2 when we're talking about New York. And we're talking about Cincinnati. We're playing a 4-2-3-1 over the last five games, respectively. Then playing against Montreal, who are now famous to play the three-man back line with the wingbacks, Piston, that we call them in French. And we've seen the tactical reaction of that team also using that formation to counteract that pressure of the wingbacks. It's interesting how TFC did not do that and were better, well, were beat easily, kind of, when you think about it, by Atlanta. Never close. Possession 57%. We're seeing the pressure in the amount of passes that they accumulated with 566, 21 shots, even though only four on target. Those moments were created from those wingback position. The tactical response is interesting to look at when you think about it this time around in MLS.
Yeah, I don't know if Atlanta looked all that dangerous at times last night. I mean, the goal came off of a bit of a breakdown and a mistake. It was off wingback play, though. You're right. It was a Zavala error again, though. He deflected, he sort of lost his space, didn't get close enough to the web back, and who got a cross shot in. It was a cross, I believe, that got deflected into the top corner of the goal. So that's the goal. But when it comes to Atlanta, there's talent there, particularly up top, obviously. And if you can find someone that can channel that, they certainly have enough to make the playoffs from here. That win put them, I believe, just 2 points back. So, you know, that's sort of dug themselves out of a bit of a hole there. I still think there are issues there. And what I would look at Atlanta was what I saw Toronto doing well last night is they did create some good scoring chances. Even though they weren't playing with a lot of urgency, they still were able to create enough that they should have probably scored a goal in another night. So, you know, if you have a team that's playing a little bit more urgently or that has maybe someone that's not tending to dribble into four attackers or four defenders to kill a play. I don't know who I'm talking about at all there, but at any rate, if you have something like that, then maybe you have the goal go against. So I don't think Atlanta's an MLS Cup contender, but I do certainly think that, you know, in what's kind of a bloated East after the first four or five, I certainly think that they have enough to compete and get there, and particularly with the coach bump this late in the year. I mean, they both have similarities, TFC and Atlanta. I think the difference is that TFC, it turns out that their roster was the injuries have hurt, but the injuries could have been predicted. So I would say that the roster just wasn't as good in hindsight, right? Like, you know, yes, not having Josie there is something that you can point to and say, well, if Josie was there, but we've been saying that for years. And
it's not the first year that he's injured, exactly.
Yeah, and we've also been saying just in TFC's sense, like, oh, the injuries killed him. Well, after a while, you have to look internally and say, is there something we're doing that's causing all this? And maybe not. Maybe it is this bad luck. But this is multiple years in a row where TFC has had insane amounts of injuries. And they're all the same kind of injuries,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, like groins and like, yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so is there something in the physio staff that is causing this to happen? Something in the way they train? Something in something that they're doing? And maybe it's not, as I said. Like, I'm not a therapist expert. But that,
well, let's not forget, Dozy has his own personal physio. So.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he's gone now. But, okay. Yeah.
He used to, anyways. Oh, yeah, that was a big controversy a few years ago.
Yeah, look, clearly they're flawed. But when it comes to the point I was making is that both teams this year did something that we don't normally see in MLS, and that's as they made a quick decision on a coach. I mean, in the past, you know, in the 10 years ago, Chris Armas would have been there for 5 years and TFC would have been struggling for 5 years. But now they make choices quickly, and that's what you saw at Atlanta as well. They made a choice to move away from something quickly, and they're not going to suffer losses very often, much.
And it's just to finish on Atlanta, and that's from good point of knowledge when you look about it. Heinze was asking for a more man-to-man type of coverage from his players. And in the heat of Atlanta and the type of roster he had, players were gassed late in games. And if you look in the beginning of the season, Atlanta were leaking goals after the 60th minute. So that's a big aspect of the change of philosophy and that Atlanta will see with Pineda already, I believe, is a more aware approach of the entirety of the game and how to manage not the microcosm of every play and every duel, but look at the entirety of that game and even that macrocosm of that game in the season. Let's not forget where he's come from, Seattle. And Seattle's famous to managing the season and being good when it counts. That's a skill in itself. Load management, before load management was a thing, was in Seattle since 2016. And that is an interesting aspect.
Yeah, well, yeah. The Supporter Shield truthers out there always fail to recognize that the reason the Supporter Shield is not the ultimate prize in Major League Soccer is because it's not the ultimate prize in Major League Soccer, and teams don't set up to operate to win it, right? So there you go. And if you can figure that out, and Seattle certainly has, then you can go a long way. Look, I don't think Atlanta's going to do much this year, but if you give him a year under that philosophy, you give him a year to sort of inject some of those thinkings that happened in Seattle, then certainly with just a couple key signings and they'll have the money, they can turn it around and be absolutely an MLS Cup contender again next year, I would say.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. And I think the hiring of Pineda will be known as a really good move. It's a very smart move. And even though they might have lucked into this and have an opportunity and they asked him and it worked out and they fired Heinze, it might be their best coaches since Tata Martino. Sorry, go ahead.
Right, I was just going to say quickly, yeah, like TFC fans, to finish this, to close the book, when they're doing the coaching search this offseason, that should absolutely be thinking. I mean, I think we got lulled into the sense that, oh, the era of you having to get an MLS experience coach is over. You know, with Tata coming in, that was basically it. But the fact is, that was lightning in a bottle. And it's not that you can't bring an outside coach in, but you have to absolutely have institutional knowledge of how this league works at some level if you're going to be successful. And when you're doing a coaching search, you have to consider that. And that's the bottom line. So something to think of as we continue to cover this for the next 4 or 5 months, I'm sure, on Soccer Day.
Exactly. And right now, we'll take the break. Today's break, we'll say thank you to our sponsors. And after the break, we'll talk about Montreal's game against Cincinnati and the rest of the week, the game midweek in Major League Soccer, also Canadian Championship and the Concacaf League, right after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kev Larme with Duane Rollins. I was losing my words before the break. Needed that that little sip of water. You know, it's really useful. Sometimes you wonder, well, I would take a break. Well, because sometimes Kevin's got to drink, because otherwise Kevin can't talk. But now that that's done, let's talk about Montreal, Cincinnati. Montreal with their first trip to the new TQL Stadium. By the way, very beautiful stadium. I am so impressed by the scenics and the views of the stadium outside, the amount of money, the footprint it has. It's gigantic. 250 million US, 26,000 seats. One of the best stadiums in the league.
Yeah, there's a little bit of jealousy, I guess, when those of us that came into stadiums built at the later part of the aughts, which is both Kevin and myself. You know, Saputo was built, what, mid-2000s, I guess?
It opened the first time in 2008, and then the renovated Saputo opened in 2012.
Yeah, so, and TFC, and obviously BMO Field was opened in 2007. So both kind of that era where it was exciting to have a soccer-specific stadium, regardless of what happened to BMO after, but in the sense of sort of the stadium built for soccer, but these new ones are specifically built with, like, atmosphere and like the crowd experience in mind, and they're just another level. So for sure, you know, it's also very telling that when we talk about Cincinnati, we're essentially talking about the stadium more than we're talking about the team still 3 years in. But nonetheless, what is it with Montreal, though, and their inability to ever beat that team? They've never beat them, have they?
No, they beat them once, and that's the last game. Before that, they have lost three times against Cincinnati in three games, and they have lost two of those games late in the game where Cincinnati scored a winner late. That's before the last one, where Montreal played their first game in a year and a half, almost. First game in a year in Montreal on July 3rd. And Montreal, on July 17th, sorry. And Montreal won 5-4 against Cincinnati. That's the first draw between the two teams in the history of Major League Soccer, and since Cincinnati joined the league. But, you know, what people are going to remember is, well, we had Rudy Camacho getting another red card. Two yellows in game, and he gets a red card, suspended for the match against Philadelphia. That's his second red card this season. He's the only player in Major League Soccer with two red cards this season. Rudy Camacho, who said no one could lead anything, any categories from Montreal. We got a leader, number one in the league, Rudy Camacho, for red cards.
Congratulations.
Exactly. But when I look at this game, it's the amount of shots on target that is quite embarrassing for Montreal. 8 shots attempted, 0 on target. Montreal got the possession. They were able to pass all right, and they got a decent passing accuracy, 84% if you're wondering, and they had 54% of the possession. But they had maybe one or two clear opportunity. They hit the crossbar. Cincinnati hit the crossbar twice. Yes, the crossbar was the player of the game, you could say, but Sébastien Breza impressed as the Montreal goalkeeper. And that is the situation, because Duane, Clément Diop, goalkeeper of Montreal, well, I should say former goalkeeper of CF Montreal, has had his contract terminated. Well, an agreement to just acknowledged his contract, and right now he is probably looking for something else in Europe, and we're wishing him all the best. But we have a very interesting situation where two young Canadian goalkeeper in Jonathan Serrois of Montreal, who was on loan with Valor, has been emergency called back, and we have Sébastien Breza, who is on loan from Bologna, who's a young goalkeeper, of course, and we have James Pantemis, Canadian, of course, goalkeeper for Montreal. So that's an interesting aspect. But last night, Montreal was not necessarily lucky to get out of it with a point, but it's a 0-0 game that was a bit more edgy than you would think. And Rudy Camacho, again, putting his team in a difficult situation heading into a difficult matchup in Philly Saturday.
Yeah, first on the keeping situation, I've always felt that it is a spot in a Major League Soccer roster that you should be looking to save a little money on. And that's terrible when you're trying to just build a good football team. But the reality is, this is MLS, and you have to think in those ways. And it's always been an area that I thought should be domestic focused and should be, which in Montreal's case would be either American or Canadian based on the rules. But in this sense, it's Canadian, yeah. And that's good because they're developing them internally. So that's a good move there. Diop, know, you'll always have that shootout against Toronto. He always won the Voyagers Cup with penalties.
That's true, in 2019. And that's how he got the job. The up was never going to be the solution long term for Montreal, and maybe not for next year. His contract was due at the end of this year, and there was probably an aspect where he knows he's not necessarily wanted for the future. He sees the writing on the wall. Two young local product, two academy keepers are just behind him, and they're becoming old enough to play and experienced enough to play and good enough to play. Something's got to give, and they have a goalkeeper on loan from somewhere else. So he kind of felt unwanted. This is kind of understandable. But yeah, when you look at
well, money-wise, sorry to interject. Money-wise, too, like for Diop's position, like he's going to make $100,000 as a backup in MLS. That's what he should make, right?
He was even making more than that, but that's the whole thing.
Yeah, well, it's next contract, I meant. But so, yeah, he goes to France probably, even in Ligue 2. He's probably going to make at least that and be closer to home and closer to everything and all that sort of jazz. It just makes more sense for everyone involved.
Yeah, and I believe also the fact that he was injured and his rehab was in France. Maybe a little bit of homesickness that came into the play. But yeah, that's speculation, of course.
They're just a bit of fit, right?
Well, it is personal reason. That's the official reason why he asked the club to get his contract resiliated. But what triggered that personal reason, he was in France for a bit and then came back. Who knows? It's speculation at this point. But yeah, we'll see. And now Montreal has two Canadian goalkeepers out of three. And Breza, he's on loan. So, yes, he's maybe, in my taste, the one that looked the best so far. Jonathan Serrois looked pretty good in the Canadian Premier League. 6 shutouts out of 8 games played. And we're looking at also James Pantemis, who had more wins this season than Clément Diop. So, the future is bright between the post and Montreal.
And we should point out that Valor has been struggling since his recall too. So, yeah. Look, in Montreal, in terms of the game itself, obviously, look, they kind of are what they are at this point of the season. I don't think there's much mysteries. This is a team that early on in the year played very well defensively. Montreal did, was able to steal some points that people didn't expect them to necessarily get. We always wondered where the goals were going to come from. I think that they've done a little bit better there than we expected, which should be basically the motto of Montreal season. Done a little bit better than people expected. But ultimately, right now, when you see them in the table, it's hard to argue that that's not where they belong, right? Like, they're probably about there, 6, 7, 8, somewhere in that spot. And if they can sneak into the playoffs, then great. You know, they're going to be fodder in New England in that first game, I think, if that happens. But none of them, I guess it wouldn't be New England. It would be Nashville in that case, particularly right now, because New England would get the bye. But regardless, it would be an accomplishment. They need to score more. Goals win games in Major League Soccer. Look at the teams at the top of the table. They're the teams that score the most. And that's right now 26-4, although, you know, better than some, better than a lot of the teams below them, which, you know, is par for the course. They're below them. Isn't really better than all but one above them, right? So that's kind of where they fit.
Yeah, you're right. And when we're talking about the keepers of Montreal and then we're looking at the keepers of Cincinnati, why on earth would you waste 2 international spots on 2 goalkeepers that are over 30 years old and that cost over $100,000? I don't know. But, you know, there's a lot of things I don't understand about Cincinnati.
Yeah, then they don't know how to build a roster in Major League Soccer. That's pretty clear. There might be 5 keepers in the entire world that would be worth anything more than $250,000 in MLS salary context, I think. Maybe. Well, I mean, my brain when I talk MLS salaries sort of still sticks back to the salary cap from about 5 or 6 years ago.
So, yeah, so maybe it's like 400 that he means.
Yeah, add a little bit.
Add inflation, then that's what you get.
Yeah, like what I mean is that they'd be worth like an above average salary. Like I think you should pay your keeper league average league average starter salary is what your starter keeper should get. You know, unless you've got like Allison or something coming in, which isn't going to happen. So, and even then, I'm not sure whether they would ever have the impact that they should at a DP level, which is what you would need to do to get one of those world great keepers in. Yeah, I just don't think they make enough difference in terms of game effect. Like, does it happen to world class keeper win you 2 extra games a year?
Maybe 1 if you're really lucky. But does the fact that you overspent on a keeper and have maybe another part of your roster a little lighter, a little light on depth, does that cost you more points than your keeper's going to bring you? Those are all great medical questions, and you know I'm not an actuary. What do you call it? Actuarian? I'm not that good at math.
Yeah, look, I mean, you know, we are an MLS show, so we get deep in the weeds of these cap questions. And it's even last night on Twitter, I was having to go back to Toronto quickly to go back to the Soltado conversations. It's like, I don't think he's a good DP signing. And people are like, well, no, he's good. He does this. And I'm like, I'm not actually talking about whether he's talented or not. I'm talking about whether he fits the roster. And that's
football that's manager conversation.
You always have to have.
Yeah, no, that's football conversation. Football manager conversations, right? And that's, you know, when you're deep in the weeds, all right? Before we move on to other topics, let's take a look at some other scores in Major League Soccer last night. New England, D.C. New England come from behind win, even with red card. 3-2 for New England. Best team in the league so far. And on paper, they're going to be tough to catch. We'll look at the standings at the end of the show. Cincinnati, Montreal, we've talked about this one. Inter Miami 3, Chicago 2. Big win for Miami. It's not easy for Phil Neville to get dubs this year. And he gets one against Chicago. It's unfortunate. Chicago was kind of on a good run. Philly, who will be the next opponent of Montreal, 1-0 at home against NYCFC. Red Bull, Columbus, 1-0 for New York. First win in 7 games for New York. Dallas 0, Seattle 1. Oh, I forgot to tell you, TFC's winless in August. That was my little stat of the day.
Ah, there you go. Well, they're having just like 4 games without a win. Yeah, no, it's look, it's not good. It's there's problems there. There's no doubt. Yep. I don't think they're as bad as they are, but there's something's going wrong.
They're not as good as they need to be to make any some sort of a run in anything right now. Yeah. Nashville, Orlando, 1-1. Nashville, Orlando. That's actually a very interesting matchup because both teams are performing very well this season. Let's finish the scores. Sporting Kansas City, Portland. Daniel Chaloy with a goal in late extra time to get the rescue point against Portland at home. Austin 1, Vancouver 2. Big win on the road for the Whitecaps. And, of course, Real Salt Lake, Houston Dynamo 2-1 to finish the midweek schedule. And if you're wondering, well, you didn't talk about L.A. or you didn't talk about my team, San Jose, Minnesota. Well, those games were Tuesday, and San Jose did beat Minnesota. Well, no, 1-1, sorry, a draw. And this was the 400th match of Chris Wondolowski in Major League Soccer. Congratulations, Wondo, you beautiful legend.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, a lot of those games were in San Jose, which is the most anonymous team in this league, really. Quickly, just as a general summary, I watched a lot of the New England DC game. It was on at the same time as the TFC Atlanta game, and I'm not going to lie, my eyes were drifting more towards the New England game because they are a really fun team to watch right now, and they have Tejan Buchanan, the young Canadian, that's sort of emerging as one of the best players in this league, scores another goal last night off a beautiful volley.
Off the bench. And he scores when he starts, he scores when he subs in, he scores when he wants.
Yeah, no, he's absolutely becoming a dominant offensive attacking force in this league. So, look, I do think New England is for real, having watched them a lot. Like, the question with them is whether or not they can defend enough in the playoffs, but they're not that far behind when it comes to that. They do have some gaps there, but they do also play attacking. And that's kind of interesting that Bruce Arena has decided with, you know, his swan song in there to have this kind of swashbuckling kind of offensively geared attack down the wings, try to be creative team. It's not really what you thought of him a lot of times in L.A. where he was really pragmatic in some sense. But, no, this is a good team that plays very well, particularly at home, and are going to be very tough to beat.
Just one thing, and I don't mean to correct you, but we're just talking about Bruce Arena with New England, Bob Bradley's with LAFC.
Oh, did I say Brad? So, yeah, yes. Bruce Arena. Apologies for that. I don't know why I said that, because even in my mind I was seeing him in his slovenly dress when I was saying that. At any rate, I think I've been thinking of Bob Bradley because of the TFC conversations earlier, and you can draw your own conclusions from there. The other quick thought, Nashville, 11 draws.
That's insane, which counts for a little, like, basically a third of their points in the Eastern Conference. And let's take a look at the standings, Duane. New England, talked about them. They're on top with 46 points, 14 clear of Nashville, who are second right now in the Eastern Conference. New York City FC is third, 31 points, tied with Philly. Orlando also on 31 points. That's a heck of a battle in that midfield for, of course, home field advantage. That's that battle, and that's the reason why it's important. New England, they're not going to go anywhere. They're going to get the bye. They're going to finish there. That's not a problem. Let's take a look at the other playoff spots. There's a little gap, 4 points gap. Then you got DC and Montreal, both on 27, 6-7. Then in the non-playoff side of the standings, Columbus 24 points, Atlanta 24 points, New York 22, Chicago 20, Miami, Cincinnati, and then TFC. That's going to be a very tough task for anyone to unseed another team. There's a few good teams on that side. There's Columbus, there's Atlanta, and there's even New York that could have arguments to be a playoff team. Anybody on the other side who's going to slip out, Orlando, Philly, they're good. DC is playing really well under Lozada. I'm not expecting them to slide that much. The team on the bubble might be Montreal. So there's maybe one spot that might change. But that's your standings in the Eastern Conference. For now, it can change quickly.
Yeah, Columbus is the big, you know, we talked a lot about Toronto, and Toronto, I think, is the story negatively this season. I'm not even trying to be a homer when I say that. The fact that they're in the wooden spoon position is absolutely a story. But the Crew, who are the consensus MLS Cup favorites by all of the so-called experts out there, I'm being a little bit bitchy when I say that, but all of the experts out there were picking Columbus, and we were the only show to say, I'm not sure, but I didn't think they'd be out of the playoffs. So that is a disappointing thing for Crew fans.
Here's my very dumb and layman's the way of thinking sometimes, but you know, a broken clock could be right twice a day. Well, usually it is. It's getting hotter in the world. The world's getting hotter, okay? It's hot, and games are getting hot, and age is a factor in games. As much as, oh no, we're all in shape, yeah. When your average age of your team is a bit over 30, you're in deep trouble in Major League Soccer because you add training, recovery, and travel on the same day because of COVID. Yeah, that's the issue in 2021.
I also think that in 2020, there was a bit of an inherent advantage to MLS teams that had a greater domestic focus because of the nature of the season. So teams that relied on international players that were cooped up, were isolated from their families, that were, you know, in the Canadian teams, isolated away from even the communities they represented. I think in some ways, because of the Crew, who were a very sort of American team, that gave them a bit of an advantage that maybe other teams didn't. And I'm getting deep in the weeds with that kind of site, but it was one of the reasons at the start of the year that I didn't rate them as high as others, who just saw, oh, team won cups, so they're certainly going to be just as good. But even then, they weren't that dominant last year. They just happened to win in the end. Anyway, that's my take on that. It's a disappointment season for them, for sure, though. Even the new stadium, all that, you would expect more from the Crew.
You would expect more, but, you know, this is something that happens sometimes in Major League Soccer. Now let's move on and let's take a plane. Let's move to the West. Let's take a look at the Western Conference standings before we change the topics. Vancouver got a very important win, but I think that hole's starting to be big too. We'll talk about that in a second. Kansas City rescued a point to keep the top of the West. 37 points for Kansas City top. Seattle second, 36. LA is third in Western Conference. Of course, Greg Vanney's still playing well without Chicharito. Chicharito's been injured, and he's just on demand. He's actually training, kind of started training, but not fully yet, so that still won't happen for maybe a few weeks. 35 points for LA. Who knew that it would only take a few years for LA to recapture the motto of best team in LA? Colorado fourth, Minnesota fifth, Salt Lake and Portland are your last teams that would make the playoffs if they would start right now.
Yeah, the Galaxy have certainly done well, and what that proves is that it doesn't take long. It just takes a little bit of a direction and a little bit of focus and some tweaks here and there, and you can go from being really bad to really good in this league quickly. No 5-year rebuilding plans should be accepted in MLS, and that's what Greg Vanney, who deserves a lot of credit. I think Greg Vanney's greatest accomplishment was taking this aging and clearly tired TFC team almost to a shield last year. That should absolutely get him some kind of trophy onto its own.
Well, when we look at this year, yeah. LAFC 8 right now with 23 points, equal on points with Portland, but of course the differential is lower. San Jose, Dallas, Houston, Vancouver. And the other disappointment so far in 2021, Austin. Austin 13. and last in the Western Conference with 16 points. That's only one better than TFC. And right now, both are very good, probable Wooden Spoon winner. And when we're looking at Austin, they're spending a whole lot as an expansion team to be dead last in the Western Conference.
Yeah, I still don't think TFC is going to win the Wooden Spoon. There's too much talent. But nonetheless, they certainly aren't performing. Austin, I remarked last night on Twitter as I was watching the Whitecaps-Austin game that it was probably only the second or maybe third time that I've watched them. And that's not typical of me in an expansion team because usually you're attracted to shiny new things. But there's just something very kind of forgetful about what Austin's done there in this role. Like they have, there's not a lot of, it's kind of just guys that you would have expected to be the fifth strikers on teams like Fagundes. And yeah, it's, there's just not a lot. And it wasn't, I don't know what their identity is other than they happened and now they're there and we'll see what happens. There doesn't seem to be any excitement around them. Like even next year with Charlotte coming in, which I think a lot of people are looking at Charlotte and hoping they blow up because of a lot of the corporate sort of stuff that they're doing and the ticket prices that they're charging and the seat licensing and all that sort of stuff. And they're kind of hoping against it. I think a lot of people are kind of cheering against Miami. You say what you want about them, but they're interesting. But Austin?
Well, locally, they're having success. In the stands, they're having success. But I think it's the first iteration of an expansion good enough for the market, but not big enough and not sexy enough to grab the attention national. And I think that's where we're seeing. LA was different. Literally, it was gold, right? That gold catches the attention. Atlanta, when you start your first game with 70,000 people in a stadium and you have an owner that is, well, a billionaire like blank, it's a bit different. Austin, Miami, well, even Miami because of Beckham, but now it catches the headlines for the wrong reasons. At least up until yesterday. But I think you're onto something. I think Charlotte's going to be another Austin where maybe they'll fill the stadium. Maybe they'll be okay locally. But at 27, 28 teams nationally, you just won't get the same attention that expansion team used to get.
Yeah, Charlotte, we didn't really deal with this stuff when it happened because, I don't know, we don't get into a lot of like ticketing and supporters on this show very often because it's not really our take, but you know they were kind of generating some local excitement, and then they came out with the seat licensing plan, which was the first in MLS, and a lot of people kind of, that's the notice they're getting, right? Like, oh, let's hope this doesn't work because they might try and do it here, basically. So you know, that's kind of the press I'm getting. They are going to spend a lot, so that is going to make them a little bit more interesting that way. They have, you know, another NFL owner that's coming in that wants to follow the quote-unquote Atlanta model to expansion success. So it'll be interesting to see that. But you're right. In terms of a market, anyone who's been to Charlotte says it's nice, but it's kind of everyone that ends up in Charlotte ends up there by accident. So it's not exactly a place that you think of. And that's with all due respect to people in Charlotte.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Before the show hits an hour, let's move to the Canadian Championship. Otherwise, we'll never get to it. FC Edmonton Cavalry, big win last Sunday for Cavalry on the road, 2-0 against their rival in Edmonton. Big win for Cavalry. Wanderers at home at the Wanderers Ground versus AS Blainville, who was the champions of the PLSQ last time there was a season. Blainville fought valiantly, equalized on a penalty, but eventually Wanderers' talent prevailed 2-1 for the Canadian Premier League team that actually get a ticket to Montreal to face CF Montreal in that quarterfinal. It will be Montreal, of course, against Halifax, and that's the only game that is actually official for now. We still don't have dates, though, and those dates are to be determined. They were scheduled to be in a window, but that window actually involves Major League Soccer games, too, on the 14th or on the 15th that was maybe scheduled to play the Montreal game or Toronto game. Well, Toronto has a game on the same day, and Montreal has a game on the 15th. So something's going to give. We'll see when these games are played in the Canadian Championship, which is an interesting aspect. We have more games coming in just a couple days. York United versus Masters were the League One champions the last time there was a season. Atletico Ottawa versus Valor will take place on Saturday also. And late next Thursday, Pacific versus Vancouver for all the marbles in British Columbia.
Yeah, a couple quick thoughts on it. First off, Blainville, valiant effort. Obviously, they were outmatched in terms of talent. It was pretty clear. You know, Halifax had a lot of the opportunities. Could have probably had a couple more goals than they had in the first half. Then, you know, Blainville came out and played pretty well for a bit. Got the penalty and tied that up. And for a few minutes, you know, might have been dreaming of taking that to kicks. It goes straight to kicks and causing what I think would be the first true, like, giant killing in Canadian Cup history. I mean, we had Cavalry beat Whitecaps, but those
were the Whitecaps were really bad that year, and Cavalry was actually really good, and we kind of saw it coming.
Yeah. What's interesting in terms of the rest of the matchup, you know, I mentioned how TFC needs to focus on this all the time, and their draw is somewhat favorable to get to the final. I mean, it depends on what you think of the Whitecaps, but then again, the Whitecaps, the way this sets up, if it goes chalk, is they will likely end up facing Pacific, which is the informed team in the Canadian Premier League right now. If you are not familiar with the Canadian Premier League and you want to just check out a game, however you'd find that, I would suggest Pacific as the team to watch. They are a pretty exciting team to watch. They were built off a youthful concept 2 years ago where they didn't necessarily go out of the gate trying to win a championship right away. Instead, tried to build something there. They're owned by some Canadian soccer legends from the past that really want to make this a development team. You know, it's a neat little stadium, all that sort of jazz. And they have an opportunity to perhaps get a scalp in the Whitecaps, which, of course, aren't having a great season either. And that would be, you know, obviously a BC Derby, which would be the first type. And that would set them up, the winner of that game, if Toronto ends up winning its track, which tracks to play York, as long as York beats Masters. And I have a little bit, as much as Blainville did well, I have doubts about Masters because the differences in League One Ontario and the PLSQ is that the League One Ontario tends to be a little younger, and not having that year and just have starting their season back again makes it thing like that's a big ask for those guys to beat a pro team. So I suspect it'll be York TFC, which will be the first proper Toronto derby of all time. So that'd be fun. But nonetheless, if that happens and Pacific were to upset, or the Pacific Vancouver game to happen, you could potentially, that's the path Pacific is going through. You have two MLS teams that are having terrible seasons are what's in front of them. So they would not necessarily discount the possibility of themselves getting through, is what I'm saying. So there's some interest in there. I still expect it'll be a Toronto Montreal final because it always is, but
well, yes, but you know, one day it won't be. And maybe that's the interesting aspect here. Who knows?
Yeah. I, you know, if you're a wagering person out there, and you're not going to get good odds on this, but bet TFC Montreal in the final again.
Yeah, no, exactly. And it'll be interesting to see Pacific and Vancouver at West Hill Stadium in, of course, Victoria Island. Now, let's take a look at the results in the Concacaf League over the last couple of days. It was the leg two of the preliminary round of the Concacaf League, which is the introduction league, basically, to the CONCACAF Champions League. One Canadian team is taking part in this competition, and that is Forge of Hamilton in the Canadian Premier League. They were playing CD FAS from El Salvador, a team that is from the, let me get the name right, of course, it's Club Deportivo Futbolistas Asociados Santa Nikos, Duane, if you wondered why FIS, what it meant.
There you go. It's a team that if you are a hardcore CONCACAF geek, you've heard of. So this wasn't exactly a nothing team that Forge beat. And Forge has proven that this CANPL does belong at that second tier CONCACAF level. They can play with these teams. It's unfortunate with the new CCL format that's coming in next year that they won't get this opportunity anymore. And I will continue to rally on that. I do think it is a loss that you're going to have, you know, CANPL teams basically acting as fodder in this MLS Liga MXE rivalry thing. You know, yeah, a couple more get to get beat up by the youth teams of Tigres, but whatever. It is a good opportunity for them. They go to play a team that TFC fans will be very familiar with next.
Yes, and we're going to pronounce that team properly here because I've heard, oh, it's Independiente. The reals called them CAI because it's Club Atlético Independiente. That is a team that eliminated Toronto FC in the CONCACAF Champions League 2 years ago. It is also a team that has, actually, it's more than 2 years ago now, but we've seen players come out of this team. It's a team from Panama, And a certain Omar Brani came out of that team to play for Montreal after looking good, eliminating TFC, and then looked terrible in Major League Soccer.
Yeah, and he's refocused again. He surfaced it again. That's his level. Anyway, that game was February 2019, which isn't that long ago, but seems like 70 years ago now based on what's happened since. So, and I just warmed up from it, too. I was down at Beagle Field. That was so cool. It's so cool.
Okay, so maybe that's not the team I'm talking about. But, you know, Sky was an interesting team. And you sure it's 2019?
Yeah, positive. Yeah, it was before pandemic.
Because when that player played for Montreal, it was Rémi Garde, the coach. So that was, anyway.
You know, it was 2019 for sure, because it was the immediate year following TFC's run to the CPL final that they were eliminated in the first round by them. 100% it was 2019. It's February 2019. All right. We can look it up after the show. This is
perfect. But for Forge, this is a good way to continue in this competition. I did like the press conference of Bobby Smyrniotis after the game, when he was talking about, of course, how he's happy for his players. He's really proud of the way they're playing, and it's fun to measure yourself in these type of competition. 2-2, of course, the final score, and they won 5-3 on aggregate. But when you look at other clubs that are involved in this competition that we've heard of before, Independiente, CAI, as we talked about, Marathon, Real Esteli, those are teams we know before, Alajuelense, Olimpia, those are all teams we've heard before that are in the round of 16 of that competition.
Yeah, and Forge has a chance in this matchup. They beat a similar skilled team next year, and if they are able to get through this, they will have two opportunities again to make the CCL proper, which if you accomplish that on your own accord, then that's a great thing. My issue with the new format is there's too many teams, and it's too divided, and not getting an opportunity for the... What I like about the Concacaf League, it is a geeky competition for soccer nerds, and we wrap this soon because we're at, 6 hours on the runtime today. But
exactly.
What I like about it is that it does offer teams like this an opportunity to compete against each other. It's in a way the UEFA or the Europa League of CONCACAF. It's not quite that, but in a way it is. And it's that same kind of idea that teams that cannot win the CCL realistically ever do have an opportunity to compete for something. And I think that that's a valuable thing. And it's unfortunate that in the effort to appease MLS and Liga MX, they're scrapping it. But at any rate, good for Forge. We'll see them play again on September 21st.
Yep, exactly. And then they're playing Montreal on August 27th. Sorry. I'm talking about TFC here for a second and get confused. Yeah. But you know, you're right. I just looked it up, by the way. It is February 19th, 2019, to be precise, which felt like years and years ago. And everything we're saying are right. It's just that timeline, because the world has evolved so much since then that Rémi Garde was a manager of Montreal in 2019. And then Wilmer Cabrera. And that's the time of Omar Brownie, too. Interesting aspect where I felt like this was 5 years ago. That's just how much things happened over the last couple of years.
It was two and a half full seasons and a global pandemic.
Well, but exactly. The global pandemic feels like a decade you had to do it.
Yeah, exactly.
On that note, Duane and I will take a longer break until tomorrow. And tomorrow we'll preview the big weekend of action in Major League Soccer. We'll look at what's interesting also across the pond, and we'll get ready for our weekend of soccer, as always. Until then, you can follow myself on social media at KevLarmy, Duane at 24th Minute, and this show at Soccer Today SPN. And of course, as always, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.